What's up, YouTube? It's JB Tech Fanatic, and I'm back again with another video. As always, I want to start this video by thanking each of you for joining me today. If you have not yet subscribed, I'd be so honored if you consider doing so. Don't forget, subscribing is completely free. And if you like this video, don't forget to hit that thumbs up. And if you want to know when the latest content is available, don't forget to click the notifications to on. Today, we are back with a brand new video, and I thought it is time that we attack internet, Wi-Fi, and smart home devices. Now, in 2020, I know a lot of you out there are wondering, why do you still have buffering? Why do things still take forever to download or disconnections? And it goes on and on. I hope today I can help clarify how to solve those problems. I'm going to also start at the very beginning. We're going to talk about how internet comes into the home, how Wi-Fi works, do you need an extender, and much more. I'm so happy you're here with me. Let's get started. All right, lots to cover. Let's jump right in. First thing you need, of course, is the service. Recommendation that I give is that you sign up for 300 megabyte download speed or better. Hopefully it's available. Now, if it has gig service available and you can afford it, that is definitely the way you want to go. The next thing that you're going to need is a modem that's compatible with your service and also capable of the speeds that you're paying for. Now, here is a great modem. I wanted to show you this for a minute because this is how we're sold, and here's where the secret comes in that they don't want you to know about. When you go out and you buy a smart product, they want you to feel like you could just buy a Chromecast, you could just buy, you know, smart plugs and all the other good stuff that we buy, and that it will be so easy to use and we can all have it and it'll all work flawlessly. That is a lie. Here's why. Here's a modem came out, it promised gig service. The gig service was not out yet. I went ahead and I purchased this. It was over $200. By the time the gig service came out, this modem was not compatible with their gig. In fact, it only was compatible with 300, which is what I was already getting. Waste of money. DOCSIS 3.1 modem is the only modem, if you're going to purchase, that you should spend your money on. Next is going to be, of course, the Wi-Fi. Now, here's the thing. If the speed coming into your house is not fast, you can go spend $10,000 on a router. It's not gonna make it any better. If you are getting the speed that's coming into your house through the air, your router's doing its job. Now, this router, and by the way, I've been in testing Netgear's newest and greatest router. I'll be having a video on that soon. I don't like to get brand new released routers because software becomes an issue. However, if you want a tried and true router, I gotta tell you the X10 is phenomenal. So, all right, we have the modem DOCSIS 3.1. Now we're gonna have a Cat5 or Cat6 Ethernet cable. Keep in mind, Ethernet cables, though they only give us these little short ones, you could buy them 100 feet if needed. Because the next important thing, besides owning a router that's capable of the speed, is putting the router in the correct spot. When you place a router, you don't want it by microwaves, brick walls, cordless phones, mirrors, anything that's going to interfere with it. You want the antenna sitting straight up, and you want to put it as high as possible in your room or the room that you're in. Center of the house is the best place. Now, a lot of people get stuck with, oh my gosh, I only have this short cord. So they stick their router right next to the modem. They have them cramped together on a low desk. That is going to be your first problem. Now, we've talked about speed coming into your house. We put it into the X10 router. Now, this is capable of running many devices at really fast speeds. For the average consumer, what happens is when we go to the store, we buy ourselves a router. Let's just say we go to Target or Walmart. We spend $150 on a router and all is good. Here's the thing about that. All is good depends on how many people live in your house, how crowded your neighborhood is, how many people are sharing the same airwaves. These are all things that are going to affect your speed. So we have 2.4 gigahertz. This is going to be the most crowded network. Everything runs off this. RC cars run on it, your remote control. There's all kinds of things that can interrupt it. Therefore, even if you push 1,000 through it, you're very likely to only get like 200 to 500, 600 depending. So again, with the 5 gigahertz band, you're gonna have the faster speed. It's not gonna go as far. However, it has come a long ways today in 2020. So we have our modem, we have our router. I recommend a tri-band router so you have two different 5 gigahertz networks to connect anything you're gonna be streaming, you know, video, music, anything that you're gonna be gaming on, downloading, that you need a lot of speed and bandwidth, you wanna use the 5 gigahertz networks. And then everything else, smart plugs, light bulbs, any of that kind of stuff, or the stuff that only uses that stuff, you wanna put it on the 2.4. Now, I also wanna make something very clear, and that is remember the devices that are connecting to it make a difference. What does that mean? Well, you might have 1,000 coming into your house. You have the modem that's capable, the router, and it's going through the air, but your laptop might only be capable of 100. So there is no modem and router that can make your device any faster than the max that it's compatible with. Therefore, if you only have a laptop, I'm just using this as an example, that can take 100, you should get that full 100. So moving on is the cabling. A lot of people don't realize that you don't only have to use the cable that comes with your router. You want a Cat 5 or Cat 6 Ethernet cable, you could buy these things, gosh, 100 feet or more. Here's the thing. A lot of people just put their modem and their router right next to each other. You don't want to do that necessarily. The router needs to be away from as much interference as possible. Glass, brick walls, microwaves, cordless phones, keep it away from that. You also want to put it up as high as possible in an open space. To be honest, if you want the best dead center in the house, you can run a long Ethernet cable and it will make a huge difference. A lot of other things that can, you know, go wrong with this, you know, that is a given with any tech product, you know, as far as if you have just overall problems, as far as it being defective, but you can in fact get a great signal in a big house. A few tips and tricks besides what I just said, you actually want to have the antennas, you want them spread out equally and have them sitting straight up. These are very powerful antennas, you know, and though in the old days, Wi-Fi was sort of blanketed out. What happens with that beam forming technology, sorry if I'm saying that wrong, it actually locks into your device and follows you. So if you're on Wi-Fi on your cell phone, it actually is locked onto that cell phone through your whole house. This will help it from dropping signals and it will give you a much faster connection. So rebooting this, I often reboot mine maybe every 2-3 days. I would say reboot and fresh your connection at least once a week. So what you wanna do is unplug your modem and your router completely, wait 60 seconds, plug your modem back in, let it fully boot up, and then plug your router in, let that fully boot up. All right, so when do you need a range extender? Range extenders are something that I only recommend as a last resort. When you have something powerful like a Netgear X10 or better, you know, 4,000 square foot house, you know, 2-story house, I could be anywhere in my house, in my yard, corners, and I have just about full signal, and even with the 5 gigahertz signal. But let's just say you have a basement and you can't get through. I did a video on this a while ago. Now this is the X6. This is, you know, a Netgear product and this uses mesh. Mesh is more or less like the invisible line connection, right? But this is a great extender. It has only gotten better. The software updates that have come to it have just made it more and more appealing to the people that need it. So if you're gonna use an extender, a mesh extender is the only kind of extender that I recommend in this day and age. That leads me into the routers, the mesh routers. They've become very popular. You know, Google has one, Netgear has one. A lot of people ask me which one is the best one. Out of the ones that I've tested, again, Netgear seems to kind of take the cake. However, it is also something that I don't recommend. A lot of people don't understand that because they think, hey, I'm in the corner of my house and I have full signal, or I'm outside and I have full signal and I didn't with my other router. Remember, signal is not everything. What happens with a mesh system is there is one mother hub. Now, you could take that into this case too, right? We have our router and then we have an extender. It's the same thing, except they're built with multiple. Some of them have more than others, but what happens is you're walking through your house and you're connected, as an example, to this mesh hub. You keep walking and now your phone jumps to this mesh hub. You have full signal, but all of a sudden you can't connect to the internet. You can't for the life of you figure out why. And that is because all of those mesh hubs must go back to the mother hub to get their connection. It does not show you that on the phone, so you're not really sure. You're not even really sure which one you're on. You have full signal, you have no internet connection, and that is because they have lost their connection to the mother hub. They have gotten way better. Gosh, a few years ago, they were just woeful. I hated them. They're getting decent now, but I still would take an X10 Netgear all day long, and then if needed, only if needed, get yourself an X6 mesh extender. All right, so we got the service, we know what kind of speeds we need, we know what kind of router and modem that I recommend, and then we know about where we need to place it. Let's talk about all of these smart devices that we all want or that we all own. All right, so I just have a few smart items here on the table, and I also said I was gonna come back to the router. So here is the secret that no company wants us to know. And that is, they don't want an educated customer. Why is that? Well, because the expense is so great to build the proper network in your home, and they know if you understood that you need a lot of speed, a great modem, and a great router for everything to work as you see it work on TV, that not as many people would purchase it. Now we're in 2020. All this stuff is starting to be more and more wanted by all of us. That's why I recommend going ahead and spending the money if you can on building that ecosystem. But what they do, if they even do it at all, on example, a Canary camera, it'll say you need 1 megabyte per second speed for this to work right. I say hogwash to that. Now, let me explain something. Let's just say you have 100 megabyte speed. We have our X10 here because we went out and our service provider, they don't provide more than that. We have Primo equipment and we connect it. So we get a couple Chromecast, okay? We get ourselves a Canary camera, we get ourselves a Ring camera, and we have our general tablets and our computer and our TVs. Great. We go ahead, everything's hooked up, we're happy. Someone comes to your door and they ring the Ring doorbell. And when it connects, you just get the little buffering. You get the little symbol, and maybe it connects, and you know what I mean, with their faces dragging across the screen, can't hear their voices. Why does that happen? Well, let's just say you have 10 items, and you have 100 megabytes. Your router will automatically divide your speed up, and I'm just using a general number here, by 10. So it's gonna give each device 10 megabytes. Okay, that might work. Here's the problem, and we're gonna go back to the beginning. Our internet service providers typically never give us the speed that they promise. They use that term up to. So let's just say you went out and you spent $800 on equipment, you have a service with 100 megabytes, you have 10 items, we divided it by 10, each item gets 10, but all of a sudden, it's busy. All the other neighbors are on the internet at the same time. Now you're only pulling in 50 megabytes. Now you've then cut your speed in half again by each device. But let's take it even further. Smart plugs are cheap, right? Smart cameras are cheap. Let's just say now we got 6 smart plugs, another 6 smart light bulbs, and then we have a bunch of cameras and streaming devices. You get what I'm saying. Now you're splitting the signal again and again and again and again. First and foremost, every single router has a maximum capacity of devices. That is something that you should look for. So if you have a maximum capacity of 10, and I've had a lot of people contact me when they're trying to connect their Bose 700, and they're like, it won't connect to my internet, it won't connect no matter what I do. And I tell them the same thing every time. Disconnect 2 of the products that you have connected, and boom, the Bose connects, because they've maxed their device out. Let's just say you didn't. Maybe you're at the max. Now you're getting almost, what, 2 megabytes per second per device. Let's just say your kids are upstairs on their tablets. Someone's trying to watch Hulu. It goes on and on. Vicious circle, right? But what you get is a horrible experience. You're constantly resetting your modem and router. You're constantly calling your service provider. And it's just one big nightmare. So how do we fix that? This is how you fix it. Now, I'm going to break it down for you exactly my setup. I have anywhere from 35 to 45 devices connected at all times to my network. So, first and foremost, when it comes to smart lights or smart plugs, don't always jump at the Wi-Fi only plugs. If you're, only have 1 or 2 items in your house, no big deal. But if you're wanting to expand and have many, many devices, get something with a hub. Philips Hue, I highly recommend Samsung SmartThings Hub. This is something that you can use different technologies like Z-Wave to shut everything off, and having just the ecosystem connected to your Wi-Fi. So in other words, instead of having, let's just say, 10 smart plugs, you're just gonna have your one hub connected to your internet, and it's not gonna be breaking that signal up as many times as it would if they were all individually ran by Wi-Fi. Next is make a list of what is important to you. As an example, I'm obviously the tech lover in my family. I want the most speed on my phone, tablet, and computer. What I do if I'm running off Wi-Fi is on the 2 5 gigahertz signal, I have my own 5 gigahertz signal that has all my business stuff, my tablets, phones, TVs that I watch often on 1. And then on the other 5 gigahertz network, anything that I know that's going to be streaming, gaming, downloading, I have it on that one. And then all the other things that are just not as important to me, I have on the 2.4 gigahertz network. Now, once you do this and it's laid out that way, what will end up happening is you're going to have, basically 3 different networks. Now, each of those networks, and I'm saying they're a network, they're all the same network, are going to be on a different channel. It is crucial that you get some sort of app, depending on whatever system you have, and you check the channel strings. So, as an example, I have my 5 gigahertz channels run on 153, 44, and then I always leave my 2.4 gigahertz on auto select. That is the only one I recommend on auto select, and that's because there's just so many other things on that network that it constantly needs to switch. When you're picking your 5 gigahertz, only pick when it tells you the channel that is the top, like some of them say great, good, excellent, whatever. The top caliber is what you want to pick. Go through each channel, and this takes some time and some effort. Go upstairs, go downstairs, go through, wherever you have thicker walls, and do the test. Once that's completed and everything's set up, you can now shut everything off by unplugging the modem and the router. Go ahead and plug it back in, like I said earlier in the video, let the modem boot up fully and then the router boot up fully. Everything will automatically connect. Start doing speed tests at that point. If something is bogging your network down, or you find that it's just causing more harm than good, you can actually block certain items especially with Netgear, you could pick, like, example, I can say, I don't want this computer to connect to the internet. So if you have a, you know, a little kid that's getting on something that's doing that, you can always block that. But once you follow that, so we have product, first we have service, which, by the way, you need to hold your service providers accountable for the speed that they say. If they tell you you're going to get 100, you need to fight for that 100. Once you get the right equipment and the right speed, now it is all about setup. This is why you can see one item and it will have 100 horrible reviews and 100 amazing reviews. That's because everybody has different modems, everybody has different service providers, and everyone lives in a different atmosphere, meaning their home. They have more neighbors or whatever it might be, right? Apartments would be the worst. So we got the provider, the equipment, our setup, everything's connected. At that point, you should no longer have issues. What I'm saying today is, if you want to have the best experience, learn about what you're getting, right? What I said, they don't like the consumer to be informed about the speed and the products. But if you're going to go out and spend $200 on a ring, you want it to work, darn it, right? So let's make it work right by having enough speed and the right products to do so. All right, so going through this for a while, I want to give you some solutions and the secrets to getting the proper connections in your house. Let's start with our service provider. I would honestly say that 70% of us don't even get, 60% of the speed that we're supposed to get. So if you sign up for Gig, chances are you're only getting 600. Why? Well, here is why. They will constantly say that it's our equipment that is causing the problem. And here is how you get around it. You have to look at it like this. I know my internet bill is pretty expensive for this house. It's about $160 a month and it's Gig. When I signed up for Gig, I was getting like $300 to $500. And I was fighting with my service provider for about 6 months. Here's how it works. They bring the signal into our neighborhood into a node. A node is more or less like their modem for about 4 to 6 homes. They'll put a certain amount of speed, and then that speed will be under the street through coax cable into each of our homes. Now, when we get it into our home, it then comes in through our wall, goes to our modem, and then through our equipment. The problem is depending on when your house was built, let's just say your house was built in 1985. Well, chances are if that service provider built up with your neighborhood, the cabling under your street is from 1985. So they will try to tell you that in 2020 that the cable from 1985 is still good. Wrong. You have to fight for this because they won't do it automatically. But here's the thing, you're spending a lot of money, you have to push them. I went from, and this is the God's honest truth, I signed up for Gig, I was getting like 3, 5, 6, I don't remember, it was like half the speed. The moment I got them to pull it out and put new cabling under the street, and mind you, this was after telling me it was my equipment like 12 times, which I just kept getting better and better, it didn't change, it was immediately fixed. So remember, they make us think that just the cabling right here is all the cabling. There's a lot of cabling happening all the way to that node and all the way to their big box that brings it into your massive community, right? Fight for your speed. If you're not getting it, hold your provider accountable for it. It's not right. Next thing is, when you buy a product and it says that you only need 1 megabyte per second, that is just not true. If you have a streaming device like a camera that is doing 1080p video or better with audio and you can do two-way, I'm saying 10 megabytes per item. Now remember, if they're all working at the same time and they're all running two-way video, it's going to be sucking more than that. If you don't have the ability to get that kind of speed, if you don't have the assets or, you know, the money right now to buy the products, wait on buying these products because you're not going to have a good experience with them. It's almost like wasting your money, right? You want to have a good experience. The only way to have a good experience is to have the proper equipment, and the proper speed. So just kind of rule of thumb, 10 megabytes to get good download. If you're gonna be streaming 4K and you have multiple devices, you need to have a monster router, right? I recommend tri-band with, you know, speeds that at least, you know, double to what you're really gonna get. Changing those channels, and depending on what speed you get, don't run them all at the same time. Now, if you have gig, you should have no problem with that. But pretty much with Chromecast, figure you want about 50 megs per Chromecast in your house or Amazon Stick or whatever you have. There's another flip side to that. Look at the capacity of the devices. We talked about this before, but especially when it comes to these streaming products, look at their Wi-Fi capabilities. Do they have 2.4 and 5? And what are their speeds, right? Are we gonna have a good experience with them? Lastly, I want to say, truly, if you want to get the best experience, talk to your neighbors. A lot of people think I'm crazy. I can tell you, at least three of my neighbors have the same internet as I do. I challenge you right now, grab your phone, pull down the Wi-Fi, and see how many people's Wi-Fi you see, and look at the strength of the signal. If you talk to each other and you're all on different channels, you will have less problems. This is such an easy fix. You probably know your neighbor, say, listen, hey, I'm gonna be on channel 153, you be on channel whatever, right? That will really help. The less people on each channel, the better experience you'll have, as long as you stay on those channels. Remember, the 2.4 gigahertz will constantly change on auto. So focus on the 5 gigahertz signals and keep all of, if you have a router, don't forget, keep other wireless devices, if possible, as far away as you can. A quick checklist. So we get our service and we have a modem that's capable of the speed. Immediately when we get our service, we're going to do a speed test. We're going to hook a Ethernet cable from the back of the modem straight into a computer or laptop of any kind that is capable of the speed that we are putting into it. Once we know that we're getting the speed we're paying for, we are then going to connect our router. At that point, we can either do a basic setup on our router, or we can really dig in and change the setting. As I said before, we want to make sure and check the channels. My recommendation is 153 and 44 for the 5 gigahertz and auto for the 2.4 gigahertz. Next, we are going to then go around our house and do our testing. If we have rooms that we absolutely can't get signal to, then we're going to add an extender. My recommendation again for extender is to do a mesh extender only. Of course, the X6 is highly recommended by myself. When it comes to devices like smart plugs and light bulbs, etc., we will aim for using a hub on any products that we can, and the products that we can't, we will put those on the 2.4 gigahertz network. Anything for fast speed downloading, gaming, streaming, Wi-Fi direct, we're going to use the 5 gigahertz network, and we are going to place our router as centrally located in the house as possible with a Cat5 R6 Ethernet cable. Remember, antennas pointing straight up, and anything that you want to hardwire in the back, hardwiring will always, always, always be the fastest. Now, again, you can hardwire anything with the Ethernet from the back of your router. Don't forget about that. And pretty much at that point, you should have a problem-free smart home. I hope this helped. I know that it really can cost a lot of money. It's never fun to go out and buy a router and a modem, but I can promise you this, it will definitely be worth it. You will no longer have buffering, disconnects. You know what I'm talking about, nothing worse. Dad, the Xbox won't connect. Dad, Hulu's buffering or Netflix is buffering. I know you know what I'm talking about. Okay, well, that pretty much sums up all of my recommendations. Remember, if you want to know all the products I recommend, I have a link in pretty much every description in my videos to my Amazon page. Everything I do a video on and I recommend is all in one place on my Amazon page. As always, I'd like to slow down for a moment and remind each of you, life is so short. Don't forget to love your family, love your neighbors, take care of each other. Never put technology in between human interaction. Don't forget to spend time with each other. Look, the world is a sick and twisted place, and the only people that can change it is you and I. I want you to know also, I do YouTube for you and you only. If you need my help and I did not cover it in this video, reach me in the comment section. You can also find me on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at JB Tech Fanatic. I want to say thank you one last time, invite you to subscribe one last time. I can't wait to talk to you in the comments and see you in the next video. And until then, I'm JB Tech Fanatic and I'm out. Peace.